posh accent, which had literally been bashed into me, kept leaking out. So in that particular gang, I was tolerated as an amusing mascot.
He loved fun fairs. I mean, you know, like me, when we met, we'd both been through the Teddy Boy thing. I might always associate fun fairs with that somehow, because it's a period of my life, and so does he. So did he. And he worked on the Kursaal. And painted the Big Dipper and all that sort of stuff.
The Kursaal was almost a full-time job, because I did the Dodgems until eventually I got onto the water chute. And in the winter of the Kursaal, I would paint the carousel horses and the ghost train. So that was really an exciting job.
In 1962, Vivian enrolled as a student at London's Central School of Art, ignoring Dad and embracing Dada.
It was on the 25th of September in 1962. He turned up this enormous ginger geezer, and this was Uncle Vic, as he was known in those days. He was a massive guy. He's 6'2"-ish and probably a big 15 stone then. And we played a game that night. He loved word games. We had to fill in sort of a sentence or a phrase, tear it down the middle, put them together. You just got stupid things. And one of the things that came out of it was Bonzo Dog, Dada Band. And later that night, we decided to form a band. And he moved in then, 164A Rosendale Road, West Dulwich. Put a plaque up if you're watching, present owner. And anyway, that's how it started.
The name soon changed to the Bonzo Dog Doodah Band.
Viv turned up with Rodney in an Irish pub in New Cross, which is near Goldsmiths College, where I was at art school. And I'll never forget it, because he came in into this big heaving Irish pub wearing, you know, Victorian frock coat. And he was quite plump in those days. And he had Billy Bunter trousers, check trousers. And he had horrible little violet pince-nez glasses, oval. And a euphonium under his arm, and these huge pink rubber false ears.
We would spend 3 hours dandifying ourselves up with waistcoats, cuffs, collar-attached things, little tinder boxes with the matches, spats. We'd nip into a Turkish bath in the afternoon and pamper ourselves, and then come back home and get changed and leap off to the Royal College of Art for one of the great gigs.
Ladies and gentlemen, once in a lifetime in showbiz, you come across a really fabulous personality, someone with a certain something, an elusive quality. Is it integrity, talent, personality, perhaps even a touch of magic that goes a dickens of a long way towards making one day a really great star?
And you, and no one to worry us, no one to hurry us through. History we're bound to gaze at the sky and try to guess what it's all about, then we can figure out why the world is round.
We started playing in the pubs, passing the hat round, and it became very successful. We made a terrible racket. It was more enthusiasm than anything. It must have been good drinking music, because, you know, people stayed and drank a lot. And so the publicans adored us. And by the time we were finishing art school, we were playing 5 pubs a week.
Little Sir Echo, how do you do? Hello. Hello. Little Sir Echo, I'm very blue. Hello. 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 Won't you come over and play? You're a very nice person, I can tell by your breath. But you're so far away.
As art school Dadaists, they took found objects, old records, and remade them as art.
It's a bit out of tune. But we used to, the Bonzos used to go down to the flea markets and buy old 78s, and you wouldn't know what they sounded like, but if they had a daft title, I mean, we've got Alibaba's Camel from there, and Mr. and Mrs. Mickey Mouse, and Hunting Tigers. They all came from these 78s that we found in the markets were, he paid a penny or tuppence, you know, huge investment.
And he loved this, and he would buy all these. Nick, look at this one, Rodney. I got it for a penny. It's worth twice the price.
I brought my love an apple, she let me hold her hand. I brought my love an orange, we kissed beneath the bed. I brought my love a banana, she let me squeeze her tight. I'm going to bring a watermelon to my girl tonight.
See, all that kind of, you know, racy fun of the 30s. And of course, Viv used to muck about with the lyrics. And in particular, this one sticks in the mind. Last night on the back porch.
If skirts get any shorter, said the flapper with a sob, I'll have two more cheeks to powder and a lot more hair to bob.
You know, good honest vulgarity. I mean, Viv knew that, I think, from his seaside days, you know, the naughty postcard.
He was always an artist. He always, you know, a lot of his art went into the band, you know, props and things like that. But he was always painting and sculpting away and carving wood.
We were very happy bumbling along, you know, playing these silly old things, and we weren't writing anything at all. We were just finding daft numbers. And really, it was Viv and Larry who kind of moulded the look of the band. And I said, no, look, let's just go for these sort of spiff suits and two-tone shoes and dreadful ties. You know, there's some shockers out there, still are. But the trouble was, the next thing is on Top of the Pops, there's Winchester Cathedral by the New Vaudeville Band, and they're wearing the same suits, same shoes, same ties. I mean, Viv and Larry were really gutted, really angry. I mean, it was the first notion that they knew, you know, they were in show business. So it was sort of house meeting, you know, it's all right. And Larry it was who said, look, let's play any bloody thing, you know, rock and roll. Why should anything be sacred? You know, we're just taking the mickey out of sort of 30s jazz or something, whatever. You know, let's just do anything. And then, of course, it was all opening up. And there were wonderful things to send up all around you. And, but it was painful at the time. But if it hadn't been for that experience, probably Viv would never have written anything. I'd never have written anything. I mean, Larry never wrote anything anyway. He was always blowing kisses.
We were not really thinking of it professionally, you know, a life in rock and roll professionally at all. It was going to be art, art, art. And we just thought we'd try this tour of the Northern Cabaret Clubs. And they were a joy. They were just great, great nights, great, great times.
The upshot was we got an offer of doing 6 more weeks cabaret up in the north after we'd done our finals. So it was a kind of dipping our toe in the water of becoming professional and then deciding to do it all the time. But I mean, I don't think anybody in the band had thought about it in terms of being professional.
Life's like that, isn't it? I mean, end of the other day I was sauntering in the West End when suddenly I was set upon by hordes of fans and admirers who wanted to touch my clothes. Wildly I sought for sanctuary and I found myself in the darkness of a cinema. Normally, of course, I wouldn't be in there, but that day I saw something rather special, something that really moved me. I want to share this experience with you. It was the sound of music.
appearances on this Python-esque TV show and constant gigs meant that they were always on the road.
We got up for breakfast in this guest house hotel, and the lady there was very obviously proud of the menu and went through this incredible list of what you could have for breakfast. You know, fried eggs, sausage, blah, blah, blah. There were about 20 items. And he sat there and said, what's the most I can have? I've never forgotten that. What's the most I can have? Which, you know, sums Viv up in many ways. You know, he had an enormous appetite for life.
And we go into blue suede shoes. Viv would come out. That was his entrance, to come out on blue suede shoes. And at a given moment in the song, we'd all start miming, you know. Drums going like this, you know, Viv's at a loss, where's the music gone? Would find something to kick. And we'd all start playing again. So the only thing he could find to kick was the grand piano. We got docked £80 for a scratch on the grand piano.
The game became sort of, if you thought of something, you did it, surprised the others on stage with it. If you got a laugh, it stayed in. I'm probably exaggerating there. We did obviously have to rehearse for new albums and things like that. And that's how the film Son of Exploding Sausage came about, which is this wonderful bit, which almost like in a silent movie way expresses Viv's relationship with the rest of the band. We're all unloading the truck and he's pretending to be afraid of heights.
Vivian came to me and said that he was very worried that the band was getting stale, they were doing the same thing again and again, and they had to take a break and rehearse and write new material and put a new act together. And I said, look, you know, you realise that if you take a week off, that's £500 lost. If you want to take a month off, you know, that's £2,000. Do you really think you can afford to do it? And he said, look, we cannot carry on. We've absolutely got to stop and put new material into the show. And I said, fine. And I found them a rehearsal hall in Acton, and they installed themselves and started rehearsing. And after a few days, I phoned them up and I said, okay, how are you getting on? And they said, oh, well, it's very, very early days yet, you know, we're putting a few ideas together. And no, I don't think it's a good idea you come down. Well, let's leave it a little bit longer. And a week went by and same sort of dialogue. And after 10 days, I was getting a bit, I wouldn't say suspicious, but I really wanted to know what they were doing. So I went down there and Vivian was there, no one else was there. And I said to him, okay, well, whatever you put together, let's go through it. And he said, well, they're not really finished, these numbers. And I said, well, give me some idea of how they're coming along, you know, just go through each song in turn. And he said, it's gonna be very embarrassing, you know, there's just one of you. And I said, but I'm your manager, you know, forget, you don't need an audience. Just do whatever you would do and pretend I'm the audience. And he said, well, I don't really think we can do that. And I said, well, why not? And he said, well, actually, I've been building these rabbit hutches. I said, rabbit hutches? Why are you building rabbit hutches? He said, well, I've got nowhere else to build my rabbit hutches and I've got nowhere to put my rabbits.
Eventually, the band ran out of excuses, and in the summer of 1968, Neil came up with their one and only successful single.
I don't remember us being that interested in having a hit single. I think it was something that record companies said to you, you've got to have a single. We were getting so much pestered thing. But one afternoon I wrote something called Urban Spaceman, literally in an afternoon. And I said to Viv, I think I've got something that might be like a single. And get them stopping moaning at us. Viv used to hang out quite a bit with John Lennon and Paul and muck about down in, you know, sort of like speakeasy, whatever, pretending to be English gents, whatever. Because Viv had this extraordinary physical presence, you know, of being an authority figure. You know, it's entirely misplaced, you know, but yeah, it gave the impression of being, sort of being trustworthy in a way. But anyway, sort of, they're down there, and he's moaning about the fact that we've got, you know, our poor manager was always watching the clock until Paul said, well, I'll come and produce it for you.
And to have somebody like Paul producing was great because he knew exactly what he wanted. And we didn't sort of fart around. We, you know, we did as we were told kind of thing. And we did the track very quickly. I think Paul's playing ukulele on it.
So that's how it went. You know, our one hit came about, really, because it was produced by Paul McCartney. Although the band did everything they could to sort of try and keep it a secret.
I'm the urban spaceman, baby, I've got speed.
My first encounter with the Bonzos was when I was about 12, and I'm the Urban Spaceman became hit, but that really was so untypical of them. It's just a great pop song.
I'm the Urban Spaceman, babe, and I'm making out. I'm all
alone. I mean, I think Viv hated it, to be honest, but although secretly he quite enjoyed playing the recorder on it, because he came up with that recorder line.
And like a lot of people, I flipped over to the B-side of our platter, as Vivian Stanshall put it, and heard Canyons of Your Mind.
This is the B-side of our single, Sports Fans. Hope it makes you sick. I don't really mean that. Honestly, we're very nice chaps, really.
In the canyons of your mind, I will wander through your brain to the ventricles of your heart, my dear. I'm in love with you again. Cross the mountains of your chest, I will stick a Union Jack. Forest of your cheetah, through the holes in your string vest.
Something struck me as most unusual and extraordinary about this sort of half an Elvis impression and half a weird fantasy, you know, in the wardrobe of my soul in the section labeled shirts.
My darling. In my cardboard-colored dreams, once again I hear your love. And I kiss, yes, I kiss your perfumed hair.
But she's not there.
The sweet essence of giraffe. And each time I call your name, oh, how it hurts! In the wardrobe of my soul.
Oh, my soul.
In the section labeled shirts.
I am forever incredibly grateful to it because it awoke, I think, in me the Bonzo stuff, particularly Vivian's work on it, awoke in me a delight in language almost for its own sake, for the crunch and pleasure and surprise of it, the rhythm and the texture.
There was always Viv's stuff that I liked best. Those were the tracks which I tended to play from the records. But I don't know how many times I saw them and in how many different places, but you're always guaranteed a good night out.
One of his favourite tricks from the early days was being the parrot. You know, bugger off, bugger off! He loved this. He loved performing parrots. And I had a parrot. So, you know, that was it, really, Mr. Slater's parrot. And he wrote a song about it.
When Mr. Slater's parrot says, uh-oh, a geezer likes to get one on the go, we hope to hear him swear, we love to hear him squeak, we like to see him pointing fingers in his horny beak.
Hello! He did put people in parts. He had a band around him that were the characters he wanted, and he found them. You know, even if it took years, he worked with the kind of people that interested him and were kind of always stereotypical of what was going on in his head.
The Bonzos were now the court jesters of the counterculture. In 1969, on the back of their chart success, they set out on the first of two tours of America.
We were mostly flying here and there, and we decided, I think, in Boston to hire a car, see a bit of America. And I drove all the way. As you get going, you realise how far it is. And, of course, if anyone's driven with a four-year-old in the back, you know, will know, you know, are we nearly there? You know, so the Bonzos is a thousand times worse. Ooh, look at that! Shall we go over to... No, we can't. Larry is giving me theory 98B of what to do in America in 1968. He said, you should never pull in on the near side lane at a toll station. You're like, why, Larry? So because there's always a police station nearby, and if you look odd, they're going to come and hassle you. Oh, don't be ridiculous. And then the next minute, you know, a patrolman sticks his head through the passenger side and says something incomprehensible, like, yeah, you fellas give up, and disappears. And everyone's going, well, what did he say? I don't know. So I start pulling over into this parking lot, and so Viv said, oh, never mind, just drive on. You know, I said, no, Viv, I really think we should pay attention to this. And but it's a kind of standoff, you know, we're there, and the patrol car's there, and the evening sun is beating down, and we do look weird, you know, because we've got all the hair and things like that, and Legs Larry Smith had got a pair of trousers made out of Holiday Inn towels with a, you know, big green stripe down each leg saying Holiday Inn. But anyway, the doors of the police car open, and out they come, and they come over, and they look menacing, and they got Ray-Ban sunglasses, and one of them actually did have ivory-handled six guns. And I could hear Viv getting really huffy in the back, and I thought, oh, please, Viv, not now. And the policeman then says, you know, the main question he wants to answer, you got any pot, you got any shit, you got any dope? And he said, well, no, we've got nothing like that, officer. We're from England, we're pints of beer men, you know. And they said, you got any guns, you got any knives? I said, well, heavens, good, no, why, you know. And then he said, well, what do you use for self-protection? And at this moment, Viv snaps and says, good manners.
We arrived at the good-looking rock, not happy with all had enough. I made our doctor wrong.
Thanks, Larry, said he. It's the booze of Amida.
The first tour was successful enough for them to return to the States only a few months later. But it was a changed Vivian who set out the second time.
I think something happened between the two tours. I don't know what. But it's sort of like he began to drink more to sort of steady his nerves. I think he sort of lost his nerve a bit. And I don't know what caused that. But it was just noticeable difference. I mean, people are used to this kind of hairstyle today. You know, in fact, it makes me look like a footballer. But when we went around to pick Viv up, to actually literally go to the airport for our second trip to America, he opened the door with his hair completely shaved off.
He got locked into Valium, which I didn't really understand about Valium in those days, but he was apparently prescribed lethal doses early on, which made him all the more dependent on the stuff.
And he didn't look at ease at all. And it was the second trip in America we actually probably decided that we were going to call it a day. We felt the shiver go through the whole thing.
Yeah, I feel that the bad side of the tours did that. I felt that we were never the same band again. The sort of fun had gone out of it.
I don't know what happened back then in America, but it changed from confident, boozy, silly Viv to sort of rather frightened Viv. In a way, you know, sort of, I'd been looking forward to the band stopping, you know, because we'd been on a treadmill for 5 years, no holidays, paid three managers out, and the usual crap from record companies.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, it's the end of a show, and we hope we've done a bomb. It's all been worthwhile if we made just one of us smile.
In 1970, the band decided to split up, but not before playing out their final bookings.
Yes, it's been worthwhile
if we have made you smile,
but now we have to go.
And we were all Bonzo Dog fans, and we thought, let's get the Bonzo Dog band in to do this. It'll be, you know, riotous sort of end of term thing. So we booked them, you know, sometime in advance, and then read in Meet Enemy or something, it's, you know, their last show will be at Loughborough.
It was a wonderful, you know, charge through everything, and out of a sense of, right, that's it, that'll be it, we've got it over and done with.
The show that they did at Loughborough was so sensational, and, you know, as a bunch of us here booking the acts, suddenly being there with the most wonderful, they just let everything go. It was just a spectacular night.
I remember coming back in the van after the gig, and so that means, you know, it's all over. Then it was a kind of moment of sadness, you know, of thinking, oh, it's not going to happen again, ever, you know, like it was. And it was sort of like an epiphany night, really, because as we approached London, the dawn was coming up, and it sort of like symbolised, well, maybe the end of something, but it's got to be the start of something else.
A lot of people were very unhappy about it and realised they weren't going to get their dream in the Bonzos if that's what they wanted. And I mean, Viv certainly had the opportunity to develop a terrific solo career if he wanted to. Neil did, and, you know, he did. He was successful.
I must have irritated the hell out of him as well. But he could be infuriating to work with. But at the same time, I think we both knew we were better together than apart.
When he wasn't in it and he was on his own, I think he was very insecure about who he was, what he wanted to be, and what he should be doing. So I think that the bravado that was Viv, when he was at his most Viv Stanshall, which was the most enjoyable to be in the company of, is actually probably when he was putting the mask up more than anything. That Viv Stanshall, I think, was the master of what he was feeling behind it.
Big Grunt was one of several extremely short-lived bands that Vivian formed in the wake of the Bonzo split, performing old Bonzo numbers like this pastiche of Black Sabbath.
11 mustachio daughters running in a field of fat. The moon is full of mandrake screams, please come to us, a bat. The changing children shiver round the fire their mothers dance with strangely painted faces that smile but never laugh.
He always said during the 70s that due to the heady mixture of Valium and alcohol, that he missed the whole decade. So in the 80s, he was saying to me, I bumped into Frank Zappa the other day. I said, Frank, it must be 3 years. And Frank said, no, Viv, 13. About 10 years, gone. Don't know where they went, somewhere around. He would cast around as if looking for them. So there was this 10-year hole.
Climbing out of this hole in the mid-70s, Vivian finally went solo in more ways than one. He split up with his wife, Monica, leaving her to raise their son, Rupert.
An old man comes.
In 1974, he released his first solo album, Men Opening Umbrellas Ahead, which he recorded with a range of collaborators, including Traffic, Steve Winwood, and a number of African musicians.
The way it is.
He could hear incredibly complex parts in his head. And if someone was good enough at taking dots down, and you get an incredible sort of arrangement, which he'd just heard in his head. And he did it all on a ukulele. Not an ordinary ukulele. He had this tiny little thing. It was only about this big.
It's a ukulele in the shape of a flying duck. I haven't yet painted it. It's just got the primer down there. I can't play you any of that because the strings are still stretching. It sounds dreadful. I was trying to get one in the shape of a flying Peter Scott, but unfortunately that proved too difficult to make. Good idea, though.
How nice to be in England. Mother England's here. I stand upright in my wheelbarrow and pretend I'm Boadicea.
It's a very odd voice, in as much as the typical Vivian Stanshall song can be a very light, almost 20s crooning voice. doing songs like By a Waterfall. Or it can be an extremely rich, incredibly English. It reeks of mullard valves covered in dust from old wireless sets and a sort of South Coast, vaguely colonial sense to it, which, of course, had its apotheosis in Rawlinson End.
He used to phone me up and say, "Old Bean, come up to the house, I've got things to do." And I used to go up to the house and he's got reams and reams and reams of paper all stuck everywhere with bits of sellotape. And I didn't know what he was up to and how he was doing it. But he was writing this strange, ongoing Archers-like thing called Sir Henry at Rawlinson End. And he said, "We've got to have some music." And he was writing all this strange stuff down. And what I used to do was to sit with him during the day and translate it into something, some sort of musical form.
Rawlinson Saga had begun on the Bonzo's contractual final album, Let's Make Up and Be Friendly.
It is almost 3 years since Madge and Bobby Rawlinson pulled up roots and were arrested by the Parks Department. The mandrake screamed.
In 1975, Vivian became an irregular and unpredictable contributor to John Peel's radio show, with a series of surreal musical monologues about the Rawlinson family, which were to become an occasional feature of Radio 1 for 16 years.
Now, read on.
There were conceits in them which just had you kind of shrieking with laughter. And as I always used to say when we broadcast one of them, that one of Viv's better thoughts would probably blow my brains out.
She sighed deeply, and her mind strode back some 30 years on sensible brogue feet. Henry in uniform, the first night of the wonderful Jewish musical Oklahoma. Then after to dance the night away at the synagogue, but more, much more than this, they did it oive.
I think there was something absolutely pure about Rawlinson End as a sound, as a parody of story writing and a mixture of colonial things, all that marvelous things about, I was going to tell you about the big one, you know, this sort of coattails thrown up in front of the fire, expounding his interminable exploits before the blaze. You see, the natives said in their novels that if a chap's soul wasn't pure, the snake bite wouldn't harm him. Poor old Hargreaves died almost immediately. Horrible agony. And so on. And all that marvellous stuff about, you've probably seen the tusks in a study, use them for defacing Reader's Digest nowadays. It's the ice tinkling in memory of Viv's splendid drinking habit.
But he was very close to the chest about where a lot of his ideas came from. And I said to him once, I said, "Who did you see for Sir Henry, and how did you come across this character?" And he mumbled something, and, well, I don't know, but I'm sure he did. But I never really got to the bottom of where this strange family came from. I think there was a lot of him in it. I think he saw himself a little bit in the Sir Henry mould.
Now, where did the idea originate from? Was it from these amazing characters you met in surgeries, or...?
Yes, it did originate from surgeries insofar as I would read the story so far. Gwen and Maureen have become trampolining acupuncturists. Bob is a gorilla and insists on wearing Dr. Martin boots. Now read on. Now, I never wanted to read on. I just like the dot, dot, dot. And it was so provocative and exciting that I wanted to write things that were the story so far. I could never give a toss about the story.
Yeah.
But the actual Sir Henry and the whole hierarchy, the whole family of Rawlinson End, were all parts of me talking to myself. I talk to myself all the time.
Marvellous things like, well, you know, one of the great jokes of all time, really, which was the name of the servant, Scrotum. Which you may think is not funny until you remember that he is a wrinkled retainer. And I think Scrotum the wrinkled retainer is as good a joke as you can get. And then, of course, came the film version of Rawlinson End with Trevor Howard.
What a host of balls she had seen. Gaiety,
the brass buttons. Dear Henry, what a kind man he'd always been. There was the time Mr. Cumberpatch, the gardener, sweet old man, hated wasps, always wore bicycle clips when mowing the lawn, fell and broke his leg. He couldn't bear to see even the lowliest of creatures in pain.
What a project that was. Written by a drunk, directed by a drunk, financed by a drunk, starred a drunk. What hope was there anybody? But it's a magnificent piece of work. So Viv.
I don't know what I want, but I want it now.
Fried or fried, dear?
No!
I think we have it on video, actually. I won't say that I've watched it time and time and time again, but it's a nice thing to have as a to remind you of. To remind you of his potential, I think.
I don't like stories without pictures I can understand. I get sleepy. I like surprises. He's behind him.
What?
By now, Vivian was living on a houseboat on the Thames with his new wife, Pamela, and their daughter, Silky. In 1981, he released a second solo musical album, Teddy Boys Don't Knit.
The cracks are showing, the cracks are showing. Listen to the loonies croon.
Soon afterwards, Vivian suffered another breakdown and was slowly recovering on board.
In the east. Hey ho ho, the way things are, the clocks are baring their teeth. Tick. Grandfather stopped, time for time to flash her dazzling dentures. Hey ho ho, the way things are, the cracks are showing, the cracks are showing, the cracks are showing, the cracks.
The houseboat finally sank. And despite Vivian's condition, in 1983, the family acquired a cargo ship, the Thekla, in Sunderland. They sailed it down to Bristol and fitted it out as a shipboard theatre, the old profanity showboat.
Viv was recovering then. He was recovering. He hadn't been off the boat for a long time, and he did. One day I went to see him. He said, come on, Mr. Statham, we're going ashore. You know, come with me, I want to go into Bristol. And we walked round the markets and went in a cafe. And it was the first time he'd been out for bloody years.
Oh, twice in the last 18 months, I've been given variously 4 months and then 2.5 months to live. My body had packed up on me.
Silky Stanshall, come here!
Oh. I'd long wanted to make an opera here, and the people that pass across our stage every now and then, you say, oh, blimey, she's good, and he's a killer, and I'd like to work with that person. So when it was put upon me, and I considered whether I could actually do it in this time, because I've written the whole damn thing in 9 weeks, I just asked the people that I wanted to work with, and they all said yes. And here we all are.
Come on, Pat, go on, break a leg.
All of a sudden, I got a call. Hi, amigo, I need an overture. And I said, what are you talking about? He said, I need an overture tomorrow. And I said, all right, I'll come down. So I drove down to Bristol the next day, and he had all these strange musicians he pulled off the street, street musicians. Very good, some of them, but strange.
So you might as well.
So I sat there that afternoon, constructed this overture, photocopied it up, took the rehearsal, and then stood to watch the show.
As though you were about to play Only Being Myself. Remembering that line, I haven't said, you haven't got any booze in there, have you?
I would like to think that it's as jolly as stuff that I did with the old dog band, but it's based on my own recovery from tranquilizers, which was a particularly difficult period, and I could quite easily have suffocated in my own wailing and self-pity.
Throw me out your window, sing me in the street, drop me from a high.
always had this thing in his mind. He wanted to write songs that his father could whistle. And so, therefore, everything that he wrote on ukulele and whistled. So, therefore, all these little songs that he wrote were all part of... He classed them like music hall songs.
Uncle Gomorrah Bundy ain't meant to be married, boo. So keep your cock unto yourself, boo-hoo-y, poo to you. Oh, bugger off,
bugger off, bugger off, bugger off. Oh, bugger off, bugger off, bugger off, bugger off. Bugger off.
He had this thing about the English theatre being the end of the pier. So therefore, he based the whole of Stingford underneath the pier. And it was like, this is where you get these strange fish and the bag lady coming along.
The memorable character of a flounder called Isaiah, because one eye is higher than the other.
And all these strange characters that live on the end of the pier during the summer season of a typical English seaside town, not too well known, all a little bit down at heel.
Stinkfoot was a surprise success and sold out night after night. But triumph was as traumatic for Vivian as failure.
I was there the day that he had decided that that was it as far as the Thekla was concerned. I could see something was going on. He had a suitcase and he was looking very smart. Just give us a lift down to the station, Mr. Slater, you know. You're all right, Viv. And I took him down to Templemeads, and he got on a train to London, and he never went back to Bristol. Never went back.
Vivian was now solo again, having split up with Pamela.
There would be odd moments where you'd hear his voice on a commercial. Mr. Slater's parrot was used for Cadbury's cream eggs, I remember. Mr. Slater's parrot says, hello, hello, diddly-ding-ding-ding-ding, that one.
When Mr. Cadbury's parrot goes berserk, the geezer just can't get on with his work. He'll step one on your neck, he'll stick one on your nose. He leaves those Cadbury's mini eggs everywhere he goes.
I miss performing terribly. I like the immediacy of response from the audience.
Do you plan to go back on stage?
Yes,
in
I
the
do.
Near future?
Once I'm well enough and there's no danger of me taking a whole load of pills in order to do so.
For echo, I'm very blue. In 1988, Stinkfoot was briefly but unsuccessfully revived at London's Bloomsbury Theatre. 3 years later, Vivian himself returned to the stage, launching what was to be his final tour there, entitled Rawlinson Dog Ends.
You think he was very, he was making a comeback, or he kept saying he was making a comeback. I didn't know he'd been away. But he seemed to be quite nervous. Maybe he was sober. I don't know. But we never actually really rehearsed this material. It was very complicated material, in as much as that you would need to have played it once. You know, just sight reading, it wasn't really happening. And so we did this first performance, and it was a mess. It really was. And I think I sort of said, well, that's it. I can't really, unless we rehearse, I can't do this anymore. And left the band, you know, handed in my notice and left.
So I took over on bass, and Andrew Sheehan of Charisma came up to me and said, you've got to take this over and sort it, because, you know, it's just going to fall flat. So I had heavy-duty rehearsals all that day. The Wednesday was good. The Thursday was one of the best musical things we've ever done, in my opinion. We peaked, and it was, I don't know, it was just wonderful. It was just everybody played like a dream. Everything was there. Vivian was straight. Straight on the nail. Whether he was straight, that's another thing, but he was on the nail.
Though Vivian's final concerts weren't filmed, they formed the basis of his last appearance on television, recorded later that same year.
Stood up there at the end of the night sweating. He was so happy, but I could see the anxiety in his face. You know, it's like, yeah, I've done it, but where do I go from here? How can I sustain this? But as usual with Vivian, when he gets himself on top of it, all of a sudden, he got afraid of peer pressure, falling off the edge. I don't know what it was, and he started drinking. It started sliding down the other side.
I'd spoken to him in a few darker moments, and we had this thing. The last time I saw him, he was so, so up and so viv and so positive and so funny and such great company. And I said, I love this Viv Stanshall. I don't like the other one. And he said, neither do I, Rob.
Growing up to be like Dad, defying time's ahead, retelling stories old of days when Dad was older, younger. Now he sits and tells every comfort and sits with a washable cover. But it worries him that his life has gone by, cheerio. So he says to his son, I don't want to, I don't pay it to, I've retired, you see, me. But it worries me, how can I convey, you might turn out to be possibly an armchair like me.
Too many people, I think, wanted him to be the clown, wanted him to be something special, wanted him to fall over all the time and be drunk and entertain everybody. And I think he found that pressure very, very difficult to deal with.
One got the idea that he was sensing the end, and he started to tackle a lot of these issues that had been bugging him and inspiring him all his professional career. Yeah, I think that was what was probably happening there, you know. He wanted to get things tidied up.
What the hell am I doing this for? What the hell am I doing this for? 'Cause I'd rather cut my hands than I'd let a stranger play my lead guitar. I'd rather cut my hands than I'd let a stranger play my upright piano. I'd rather cut my hands than I'd let a stranger blow my saxophone. Sometimes I get so weak-willed and crazy, frustrated and angry, so wired up and wheeled, and so lonely, 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 so lonely. I let a complete stranger play around with me.
For the last few years of his life, Vivian lived alone in a top-floor flat in North London. Close friends tried to keep him sober, checking him into a number of clinics, but he grew increasingly frail.
He'd had a skylight put in his bedroom roof so that he could watch the stars. And he used to lie there and look at the stars, and he was drinking brandy, and he had a lot of chest hair, and he was smoking these cigarettes. And I remember saying to him once, I said, you know, you're dropping these cigarettes on you. You want to be careful. Oh, I'll be all right, amigo, he said.
Why am I so choosy? Who do I think I am? Why am I so picky when I know that a quickie will come to a sticky end?
I think it was when a lot of us had known him a long time, you knew would come. Eventually he would get pissed and he would accidentally, shall we say, kill himself, as he did with a stupid accident, you know. I mean, the number of times I've put his beard out, you know, those roll-ups, that was a, you know, and they eventually killed him. I mean, if they weren't going to kill him from the inside, they killed him from the outside. He set fire to his bloody bed, you know, and asphyxiated him.
His
Walking on the water, spreading his light. He raises up a dead man, makes him feel alright. I can see him waiting, spreading his light, spreading his light all around.
I hope this program, you know, sort of reawakens some interest and people, because I think he was a, you know, is in terms of what he's left behind, a national treasure.
When your ship is sinking, he's the bung in your punt. If you can't find your keyhole, hooray for Holman Hunt. He even works at weekends, he is never out to lunch. He is spreading his light all around.
I think there's a comparison you could make if you wanted to between Viv Stanshall and Peter Cook, and they both suffered this awful, mimsy, British middle-class judgmental thing of saying, yes, slightly disappointing in the end, never really fulfilled their promise, this school report view of people's lives.
You also think the wrong people died. I could make a list of people whose departure would not distress me in the slightest. That sounds fantastically cruel, and there is a hard side to me. But the people whose work you I'd love to know what he'd be doing now, and I'd love to have seen him developing and growing into a kind of rather bookish and eccentric old age, and he would have been hilarious, I think.
He remained defiantly and completely himself all the time, and I'm sure that was difficult to live with, I'm sure it was difficult to work with, but it's what made him interesting. It's what made him the subject of this film. You wouldn't be making a film about someone who compromised, who was nearly as funny or nearly as weird or nearly as peculiar as Viv Stanshall. The fact is, he was as weird and extraordinary as well. He's still influencing the Ice Bucket. He was exactly who he was, and therefore to judge them for not being Mr. Respectable, for not being the school prefect, is absurd.
In the night he made of poplin, spreading his light. The shepherd plays Scott Joplin all through the night. Squeezing on his organ, spreading his light. And clinging to his old rugged claws. Get that good man's haircut, spreading his light. All you can say is there, but for the grace of God go I. I can see him waiting for you to say goodbye, spreading his light.
How utterly tranquil it is here. Here I'm trying with these long and skillful casts to ensnare a barrel of scrumpet. Down there you can see Vincent van Gogh, or at least a part of him. Yes, I've got one on the line now, and it's good to feel the old robbed thrusting and surging and quivering between the hands again.